Does pain exist in any real sense? Because according to philosophical behaviorists, pain is merely a disposition to act in certain ways. For instance, if I step on a Lego, I feel pain, but this pain, behaviorists argue, is simply my tendency to jump up and down or rub the sore spot, cry or react in other ways. Pain, like any other mental state, is only a disposition to act. So, in a way, the mind doesn't truly exist in this theory. Well, I guess that depends on what you mean by existing. Consider glass, for example. We say it has a disposition to break if it's struck. But does this disposition to be fragile actually exist? Oh, by the way, much of inspiration for this episode is taken from this book by Ian Ravenscroft, Philosophy of Mind, which is a fantastic read if you're into this kind of stuff. A key aspect of behaviorism is its physicalism, meaning that whatever is going on in here is made out of the same material as everything else in the world. We've discussed before Descartes' substance dualism, which argues that mental states are distinct from the body, composed out of something that isn't analyzable by physics. Philosophical behaviorism, in contrast, asserts that mental states are fully physical as they are merely dispositions. To clarify, philosophical behaviorists don't claim that there's a fixed way to react to pain. People vary, so it would be odd if we all responded identically. Pain isn't limited to behaviors like rubbing a sore spot or crying, for instance. Everyone reacts differently. This may seem counterintuitive. You might think, I know what pain feels like, and it isn't just my way of reacting to it. But behaviorists argue this way in part because of the verification principle of meaning, which states that a statement is meaningful if and only if it is either empirically verifiable or analytically true. Empirically verifiable means that we can confirm it through our senses in some way. Analytically true refers to statements like, every bachelor is unmarried. We know this is true by the meaning of the terms, not by experience. This principle was central to the logical positivist movement, which was highly critical of any metaphysical claims, things we can't verify with our senses, such like Descartes' immaterial soul, for instance. The critical point here is that I can't empirically verify someone else's mental state. I can't look into another person's mind to see if they're in pain or not. But I can observe their behavior and infer a likely mental state based on it. This removes the spookiness, so to say, out of mental states, making them concrete and observable. Is it a successful approach? I'll leave that for you to decide. But I should mention that the verification principle of meaning is almost universally rejected today for several reasons. One major issue, for instance, is that it's self-defeating. We can't empirically verify the principle itself, and it doesn't seem to be true by virtue of its own terms, right? But that's probably not a major issue for behaviorism. Behaviorism's strength lies in highlighting the strong connection between dispositions and mental states. For example, if I crave coffee, I'm inclined to get one. If someone claims they constantly yearns for coffee but never acts on it, we might think they are probably lying, right? So there seems to be a necessary link between certain mental states and corresponding dispositions. However, this view might feel strange because we're so used to thinking of mental states as private experiences, personal, internal sensations that we might express but don't always act out. Behaviorism challenges this directly, suggesting that mental states aren't inner experiences, but only behavioral tendencies. This is a big challenge since it contradicts our common sense understanding of mental states, at least I would say. But now let's explore some more serious issues. First, we have a strong intuition that certain mental states cause other mental states. For example, if I believe today is Sunday and I believe Sunday is a day off, those beliefs lead me to believe that I can relax. But can behaviorism account for this causal chain? No, it seems not, right? It can only explain why someone relaxes on Sundays without addressing the mental states leading to that action, right? Another significant issue involves scenarios like the super stoic and the perfect pretender. Imagine Paul. He has a rare condition that prevents him from feeling pain. Even if he steps on a Lego, he feels nothing. But Paul is embarrassed about his condition, so he learned to imitate behaviors associated with pain so convincingly that no one suspects his condition. When a behaviorist observes Paul stepping on Lego, they'd conclude that he's in pain, but we know in fact that he isn't, right? Here, behavior alone doesn't reveal whether someone is experiencing pain. Imagine Percy, who grew up in a community that treats Marcus Aurelius' meditations like it were the Bible, and he was trained from a very young age. When Percy steps on a Lego, he feels excruciating pain, but has trained himself not to show any reaction. A behaviorist observing him would conclude that he isn't in pain because he doesn't react at all. These examples show that behavior is neither necessary nor sufficient to determine if someone is in pain. This is a significant challenge for philosophical behaviorism. Before we wrap up behaviorism, let's touch on another related approach, methodological behaviorism. This approach aims to predict behavior based on observable stimuli and responses. For instance, if a rat in a cage pulls on a lever when and only when the light is on, it receives food. The rat learns that pressing the lever when the light is on results in food. From this, we can pretty safely predict that whenever we turn the light on, the rat will pull the lever. So here we've discovered a strong connection between a specific stimulus, the light, and its behavior, the lever press. But can we truly make reliable connections between stimulus and behavior in the complexities of human life? There are other issues as well. Neither philosophical nor methodological behaviorism addresses the problem of consciousness. Any theory that overlooks consciousness, in my opinion, is incomplete. So if you're like me and not fully satisfied with behaviorism, I recommend you to check out this video here about Descartes' substance dualism.